YouTube subscribers. It's about 5 o'clock in the morning, and I'm in lovely Derbyshire today. To my right, over there, behind this tree line, is a nature reserve, believe it or not. And over that side is some industrial units. I'm going to take a little walk today. I've seen a few bits of wildlife. I stopped out overnight, not too far from here, and as I was laying there, a hedgehog came and sort of said hello to me, snuffling around and cracking twigs, literally about 2 feet from my face. Also saw quite a few rabbits running around this morning, running around even, if I could talk properly. Heard some deer, didn't see them, but they're quite good at moving around stealthily. And that's about it so far, so hopefully I shall have something to report or show you shortly. Okay, speak to you soon. Here we are a couple of minutes into our walk, and there's loads of reed mace just next to this track here. There's the track. It used to be an old train line. Until recently it still had all the tracks down there, but they've obviously taken them up recently, which is surprising. As I say, reed mace growing in the very marshy, boggy ground that is over there, and some of it is on the path here. And this can make quite a useful tinder, although it flares rather than smoulders and burns properly, but it will catch various other tinders from like spark into this and get that little bit of a flare, and that will light other very dry tinders. Obviously this needs to be dry to work, which it isn't at the moment as it's all sticking to my fingers. Another good use for that is insulation. If you're out and about and there's plenty of it around, like there is over there, as long as you don't get soaking wet trying to retrieve it, like, and or drown or something ridiculous, then you can get it and stuff it inside your clothing, inside gloves and whatnot, and it'll provide a really nice warm insulative layer. There's quite a bit of it laying around actually in different places, and more of it on that side as well, and obviously plenty of birch around here too, another source of natural tinder if you need it. Probably be able to get away with using other things other than birch around here. This area, there's plenty of things to choose from really if you look hard enough, but that's as I say, that's reed mace over there. I just thought I'd share that with you as I was walking past, and I shall continue on my journey back again. Just thought I'd say, as this is a, I know this area reasonably well, and as I said before, this is an old train line, and next to it there are quite vast amounts of sitting water, semi-stagnant pools and whatnot, and hence all of the reed mace that we saw earlier. And you'd have thought that would have been a suitable source of water in a survival situation. Obviously millbank filter or some form of filtering and boiling to make safe. But now, I'm not sure if this is true with all train lines, but I know for a fact that this train line used to run to and from a chemical works. So I'm guessing that the water at the side of the tracks may not be awfully safe even after filtering and boiling. I'm guessing it may be contaminated with some sort of chemical content, or there is certainly a risk of it. So here's some evidence of the old train lines. Those go by the sides of the tracks with the wire crossing over to sort of keep it sort of steady, sort of vibration, and stop it moving around on the sleepers. I think, although I'm not 100% sure, that could probably cause some sort of contamination in the water, being from a chemical line, and I personally wouldn't risk drinking it unless I really, really had to. Sorry for the quality of this video as well, by the way. It's on my iPhone again, rather than my camera, as I forgot to bring the camera with me. Okay, and I'll keep you updated as I pass. Okay, speak to you soon. Here we have a game trail, which is deer by the looks of it. Yep, deer prints. See a few scrabble marks where it's gone up the hill. Where are we? Just there's the scrabble marks, and there's the imprints. And he goes off in that direction somewhere. Let's see what we can find here. Not an awful lot of prints visible at the moment. There's some light ones here, very, very faint. But this is the main track. Most animals will use tracks like this as their sort of the highways and byways of the woods, to just to get around quickly from one trail, one of their trails, to another one's. Or in this case, they only cross it by the looks of it, because it goes off at that way as well. But a lot of the time, you will find tracks in amongst sort of other tracks that are like on the footpaths and bridleways, because they will use the tracks that are already there, rather than trying to fight through brushy undergrowth like that. There's another game trail there. You can see where the grass is a slightly lighter, well, I don't know if you can see on this camera, but the grass is a slightly lighter colour where it's been disturbed. And the fresh greenness at the bottom, like that, when you flatten it. See, that's sort of dark. The colour's not really great on this camera, or not on this screen, it isn't. But when you flatten it, it's quite light underneath, and there's light patches all the way down there. Even though it's not exactly well defined, the path, ignore that bit, that's where I've just been messing around with it. But that's one of the ways to see. I mean, a lot of times that you'll see bruising to leaves and brambles as well, whether they stand on it. And normally that would be a person, because animals tend not to sort of stand on the brambles and step over it. And the other animals that are likely to scramble onto it have soft feet. deer don't, obviously.
They have things on the floor all around.
Here is the willow. The leaves aren't particularly great to see on this one. Oh yeah, you can tell willow because it has alternating leaves. Where are we? Try and show you without damaging the tree. Where are we? I'll see if we can find a better example for you. There we go. You can see that the it'll focus on that. There you go. It's quite hard to see here, but the leaves aren't dead opposite each other. They shoot out staggered, sort of alternating sides. And that's one of the giveaways of willow.
Over here, next to it,
somewhere. This is a hazel, I believe. My belief. Where's that one growing from? It's growing from down there somewhere. It's growing from pretty much the same spot as the willow. Here we have good old oak. Not exactly hard to focus. Not exactly hard to spot the leaves on an oak. This is probably a scrub oak, looking at it, because it's quite thin and whippy. although it doesn't look particularly gnarly. So, and when I say gnarly, I mean twisted. But I don't, I'm not sure what everyone else has probably got a different idea of what gnarly means. Let's see what else have we got around here of interest. Brambles, obviously. Everyone's seen brambles. There we go, they're quite an obvious leaf as well, very shiny. And very crinkly sort of surface to them. There's some young ones down there. Anything else down here that's of interest? Hawthorn, I think that's hawthorn on it. I keep getting confused between blackthorn and hawthorn. I think this one's hawthorn, this one. Very three-pronged sort of, almost like the club. If you imagine a deck of cards, it's almost like the club sort of leaf pattern. I shall check that when I go home. I'm pretty sure it's hawthorn. It's times like this when I realise I don't really know that much about this sort of stuff. But I mean, a lot of people will find that out there. You'll come across plants or trees and think, what's that? But you shouldn't lose faith in yourself there. I mean, the chances are you'll know a lot more than other people do. Something's going on here. Someone's tried to set a fire in the middle of this stack here. It's all scorched on the inside. I wonder what drives people to do that. They see a stack of twigs bundled up. I should see if I can get a better angle so you can see it. There you go. That stack of twigs there. They see one of them bundled up and they try and set fire to it or damage it. Why? 9 times out of 10, forestry commissions and nature reserves will leave piles like that of twigs, like loose matter like that, debris or dry windfall or whatever, or piles of leaves, and lots of animals will use that as a habitat, as a home. Make a nice little house inside there. In piles of leaves and things, you often get quite a few snakes and things like that. And around here, we do get a few lizards, but the sun's not really out at the moment. Not as bright as it has been the last few days. But when it's out, sometimes the lizards will come out and sun themselves on the logs that are around. Also slow worms as well, and if it gets a bit too hot for slow worms, they'll go underneath the log. What's that over there? Some nettles here, obviously everybody knows, well, should all know nettles by now. And some sticky weed. And I forget the real name for sticky weed, but we used to call it sticky buds at school and when I was a kid, just because it leaves those big sticky buds all over you. Quite easy, it sticks to everything. Most parts of the plant stick to everything. So apparently it's not awfully tasty, but it's edible if you need to. You can eat it. And it's easily identifiable as well. I'm not aware of any other plants in this country that look like it, so, or feel like it. Around. I actually saw a fox earlier on this morning when I was walking the train lines. I'm now back down from Derbyshire and I'm now back in Northamptonshire, which I should have said that before. Really struggling to find anything of interest to video for you today. That's reasonably interesting. Bark on the bottom of a tree has all been scratched apart. There's something been digging at it and pulling at it. Looks like claws, marks, or teeth possibly. It could have been a lot of dog walkers come down here, so it's another bit on that one. So it's possible that a dog has come down and had a chew on it. but I can't see any indentations on it from, let's see if I can focus on it, from any teeth marks on it or anything. So it looks more clawed at than anything. Interesting. I'll have to look into that and see if I can find out what's done that, unless anyone that sees this can inform me and let me know. Much appreciated. I still can't talk, it's too early in the morning still. I appreciate all the comments, negative or positive. I'm lucky enough to not really get that many negative comments at the moment, which is, I mean, it's great. But I'd like to know, I mean, if anyone's got anything they think I've either got wrong, or it's really too boring. I know most of my videos aren't exactly riveting, but if there's anything you want to say, don't be afraid to say it. I mean, I'm not going to hold a grudge against anybody. It's a free world. And competition. I've decided what I'm going to give away as the competition prize after lots of umming and ahhing. And it's going to be a traditional striker light, or a steel striker, for striking pieces of flint with, to make tiny sparks into char cloth, obviously. And I've made these myself. I've made a couple of them now. They seem to, well, I can get them to work perfectly, so they seem to work quite well. I'm going to give one of those away. I'm still trying to think of a question at the moment, though. That's the real struggle. I'm really terrible with trying to think of things like that. But I'll get a question somehow. I don't really want to do a challenge or anything that involves a video response, because a lot of people out there don't have the time to go and do challenges or make video responses, and a lot of people don't like, although they're on YouTube, a lot of people don't like going appearing on camera or speaking to a camera or anything like that. I mean, I don't really enjoy it myself, but you know, people edit, or everyone's different. So I don't want to do anything like that, because that'll alienate people. And I mean, I'd like them to get out there and do it, but I don't. It's different when they have to publicise the results or feel they have to do something. It takes the fun out of it then. So it will be a question, and it will be a question that anyone could get if they've either something from one of my videos or something, a piece of information that's on the internet. So anyone's got the opportunity to either try and look it up if they don't know it, or go and find it somehow by looking at videos. But I'll still have a think about that one. But that's something to look out for in the future. It's been a while since I did my first competition, and I've got a lot more subscribers now, and I really appreciate that. I mean, I wish I had more time to get out and make videos for you. You've gone to all the effort of subscribing to my channel, and you've obviously watched a lot of my films, or videos rather, not really, some of them almost feature length, I suppose. But you've gone to the effort of watching them and subscribing and commenting on them, so I really do appreciate all of the subs. But yes, I keep distracting myself today with various bits and pieces, but I shall come up with a question or something that involves picking names out of hats, and offer one of those as a prize. Old-fashioned fire steel, I suppose you could call it. It's a flint steel striker. I'll even try and throw in a piece of flint, because I've got a couple of pieces of flint at home, but they're not great. They're quite a pale flint, and I'm not sure if anyone knows this. I mean, I've been trying to tell people for years, but no one seemed to pay much attention until recently. The darker the flint, the closer to black the flint is, the more sparks it will produce from the steel. It will chip more bits of steel off. because the black stuff's the harder flint. I mean, you can strike a steel striker with a piece of quartz and still get sparks. Anything that's harder than steel will do it. I'm not sure if you've seen on TV, on films or whatever like that, all these police camera action things where a vehicle's dragging a piece of metal across the ground and all the shower of sparks coming out the back. It's the same idea, exactly the same. It's just you're doing it one tap at a time rather than dragging it at high speed across the gravel or tarmac. Interesting. I don't think it's a doggy bag, shall we call it? I think it's something else. But anyway, I shall stop boring you all to death and let you carry on with your days and go and watch other videos, and I shall speak to you again soon.